All right. Good to see everyone here. I share everyone else's excitement. It's so great to have our whole church family together in one spot for one service. Really, really blessed to see you all, and thankful for this church family. We talk about it a lot, and I'm really, really thankful to be a part of this group of believers. We're certainly a part of a greater group of believers corporately with the church, but we have each other. And I'm thankful for you and thankful that you've come to church here today. And it's a special day. Special day because we got our kids with us. It's a special day because we're in one service. Because today is a special day, we are going to perform an important special ceremony. It's called a sacrificial ceremony, a sacrifice ceremony. So I've asked the ushers around the back corner, guys, we've got some wood. So I need you to come up here and bring the wood. And we got some lighters, and we're going to light a big old fire out here. And then in the storeroom, I got a couple bulls and some goats. And we're going to bring them out here. Now, all of us know, I think you may know, if you don't, you're going to learn now, that you're a sinner. We all do things that don't obey God. And we're a sinner. Raise your hand if you're a sinner. You, Mike, you didn't raise your hand. Mike, come on. I know you. We're all sinners. Say, I'm a sinner. That's right. We're a sinner. So what we're doing today in this special ceremony is we're bringing out the wood, and we're bringing out the goats and the bulls, and we're going to sacrifice them. And that's going to satisfy God, because we're sinful people. And if we just spill the blood of the bulls and the goats and then burn them up, everything's going to be fine. We're going to be completely forgiven. It's going to be really great. We're going to walk out of here completely clean because we spill the blood of the bulls and the goats and burn them up on the wood. Now, we're here with the Harvest kids. Kids from first grade to fifth grade. Tell me, will that cause us to be forgiven? I want to have a kid tell me, is that how we're forgiven? I need someone to raise their hand and tell me if they think we're forgiven when we do bulls and goats right there. No, why not? Who forgives us? What's that? It's just wrong. You're right. It is just wrong. So if that's not the way, what is the way then? How do we get forgiven? What? We say we're sorry to God and we praise God, but God says when we sin, there has to be death. So if it's not the bulls and goats, what is it? Who is it? Who? What happened? How do we get forgiven? I'm looking around at a kid. No kid knows how we get forgiven. Yell it out. Jesus, that's right, Jesus, thank you. Phew, I was worried about Cass and our children's ministry for a minute. So, I'm just kidding, I don't have wood, and I don't have bulls and goats. And the reason we don't, open up your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, it's written to the Israel nation, and they had been practicing sacrificial ceremonies for hundreds and actually thousands of years. But something changed. Look at Hebrews 10, verse 3. But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book. Verse 10, and by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. Jesus Christ eliminates the sacrificial system. We don't do it anymore. The reason we don't do it anymore is God sent a perfect sacrifice in Jesus Christ. One man died one time to forgive the whole world of every single sin. Your sin past, your sin current, your sin future. And for all those who understand when you raise your hand you're a sinner and you put your faith and belief that Jesus Christ is the real offering once and for all, if you believe that, the Bible says you are saved, forgiven, and will spend eternity in paradise in the presence of the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. That is the good news of Jesus Christ. So if you don't know that today, ask someone next to you or come up and talk to me or someone else. It's the most important thing we're going to say this morning. We're going to say some other great things from God. But if you don't understand that, well, you're not going to understand what we're going to say the rest of the way. So we're so thankful that you're here. If you don't understand that, make sure you get that understanding. It's the most important thing you'll know ever. But because Jesus Christ committed his life for us once and for all, he asked us to be too committed to some things. Because we believe that, we are saved. But then he says, I want you to commit to some things. And that's the title of our sermon today. It's called This Is Us, Five Commitments for God's People. So we're going to talk about five things in Hebrews 10 that God asks us to do that we should commit to. I'm going to take the first one, and then the four other pastors from CL are going to finish it. We're going to do one at a time. And mine is this: we draw near. The first point, the first commitment is we draw near. Look at verse 19. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near. There it is, our point. We draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Verse 19, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus. So when Jesus Christ came and he laid himself down at the altar, he opened up a way for us to have communion or closeness to God. See, the old way, the old sacrificial way, the great priest or the high priest was allowed to go into what was called the most holy of holies in the temple one time a year. It's called the Day of Atonement. Now it's called Yom Kippur. The Day of Atonement, the priest would go in, he would wash himself and put on clothes that God had prescribed for him to wear. And they would take the blood of a goat, and they would go into the most holy of holies, and they would break through the curtain. There was a huge curtain in between the holy place and the most holy place. And one time a year, the high priest, after sacrificing a bull for his own sin, would open up the curtain and walk in and sprinkle the blood of the goat on the Ark of the Covenant. And that would satisfy temporarily God's anger towards the sin of the people. And he would forgive their sins. That's what this verse is talking about. No longer do we have a high priest having to go in. Look at it. Since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain that is through his flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near. God, through his son Jesus Christ, made a way that you no longer need a representative to go before God in the most holy place. God wants you and God wants me to go directly to his presence and draw near to him. He is a God not far off. He is a God that wants to be close. When we came, when we went to New York and JT, my son, got back from Afghanistan, we're in a gym. And we know that JT's in the building. He's behind the wall. And there's a door there. And I know he's there. And I know JT, but I'm waiting. I want to draw near to him, and I can't because there's a door in the way. But then, at a cool moment, they open the door, and here he comes out with all of his brothers in service. And we're able to then go to him and hug him and kiss him. I love the picture of my wife just throwing her arms around my son, JT. But there was something in between us for a while, and it was hard. And that's the way it used to be, but not anymore, because Jesus Christ has made a way for you to draw near. And we don't have time to go into all the passages here. I want to give you two things to study on your own this week before I turn it over to the next point. Number one, I want you to go to Leviticus 16. Write it down. I want you to study Leviticus 16 this week. That's the Day of Atonement. I want you to see the foreshadowing of Jesus Christ giving himself in the Day of Atonement instructions given to the nation of Israel thousands of years before. And the other thing I want you to read is Matthew 27:51. I'm not going to tell you what it says. You'll probably sneak there now, but it's pretty cool. All right? But we draw near, and here's how we draw near, and then I'm turning it over to Pastor Ben. But our first point is we draw near, and we do it in these ways. How do we draw near to this God that Jesus Christ has now given us access to? Number one, we talk to him. We talk to him. Jesus Christ, God, is a living being. And we talk to him. And how do we talk to him? What do we talk? Starts with a P. Prayer. We talk to him in prayer. All right? How else do we draw near to him? We did it already earlier this morning. We did it in praise. We do it through worship. We draw near to the person of God through praise. How else do we draw near? By listening to him. And how do we listen to him? We listen to him by reading his word. If Jesus Christ was here right now, he wouldn't be telling us any new stuff. I don't believe he might if he wants to. He can do whatever he wants. But I believe he's going to continue to tell us the things he's already given. We have the full revelation of everything we need to know. And this is how we listen to God. We also listen to God in our hearts, because when you come to accept Jesus Christ, he gives you his spirit. And you listen and are attentive and responsive to his spirit's leading. But let me tell you, if you don't know Jesus Christ personally, he wants you to draw near like you draw near to your wife, like you draw near to your kids. He wants a relationship with you. A relationship. He's not a God on the pages of a book. He's a real living person. And Jesus Christ came to abolish the sacrificial system, to break open the curtain so we could go directly to Jesus Christ and to his Father and draw near. That's our first point.
First is we draw near. The second commitment for God's people is we hold fast. We hold fast. I wouldn't say that that's a phrase that comes out of my mouth quite a bit. When a buddy comes up to me and I ask him how his week is, and he says it was rough, I don't go up to him and say, come here, brother, hold fast. It's not really something that's in our vocabulary, but this phrase is really popular among sailors. Did you know that? Hold fast is a nautical term. You see, anyone who's spent time on a ship fishing, or this is something pirates would understand way back in the day, because when they heard it, when they heard the phrase hold fast, they couldn't just listen and go about the rest of their day. They had to heed it. See, the phrase hold fast is what the captain would yell when the ship was headed towards danger, towards tumultuous seas. See, if the captain was looking far ahead on the horizon and saw that a storm was coming, or that an enemy was coming, or that something was about to attack them, he'd yell to his crew, hold fast! And what every sailor would know, and if they're a rookie, they learn really fast. Does that mean stop what you're doing and hang on? Hold fast meant stop what you're doing. Put down the ropes. Grab something that's anchored to the ship. See, sailors hang on to a ship, but we hang on to something else. The writer of Hebrews is telling us to hold fast. Verse 23 says, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Sailors hang on to the ship. We hold fast. We anchor ourselves to the confession of our hope without wavering. See, first we draw near, right? You have to be near to it, but then we have to hang on. Proximity is not enough. So what are these confessions? What are the confessions of our hope that we're supposed to hold on to? Well, Pastor Greg just went through the most important one, and that's the promise of salvation through Jesus Christ. See, the confessions of our hope are the promises of God. Where we place our hope are the promises that God makes to his people through his word. So what are some of those? I came up with three. Came up with three promises that we as a church can and need to hold fast to hold on to right now. The first one is that God will give us strength. Isaiah 40:29 says he gives power to the faint. To him who has no might, he increases strength. I get it. Some of us feel tired. Some of us feel unequipped for new roles that we're moving into. And some of us want to hang back or give up or let others carry the weight. When we feel that way is when we have to hold fast. We have to know that God is going to give us strength. God promises strength in our weakness. We're the body of Christ for a reason. We need each other. And when we trust in the Lord and we put ourselves out there to do his work, regardless of what we think or how we feel, God promises that he'll provide strength for us. The second is God goes before us. Second promise is that God goes before us. Deuteronomy chapter 31 verse 8 says, it's the Lord who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. Do not be dismayed. And let me tell you, this is a promise that I'm holding on to right now. As a church, we're in a new season, and that can be scary. There's a lot of change. There's still unknowns. There's a lot of question marks on the future. But God's people, what we can hold on to is knowing that God's people, we don't have to go do it alone. We're not doing it alone because there's nothing that's happened, that's happening, or that will happen that God doesn't know about. So as we move forward in ministry together, we can hold fast and go into it with boldness that God's already gone before us. And finally, the third is God brings the fruit. Third promise is God brings the fruit. Isaiah 55:11, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth, it shall not return to me empty, but shall accomplish that which I purpose, and shall succeed in the thing of which I sent it. God's promise right here is that when his word goes out, it's going to succeed in the task that he has planned for it. That's a promise we can hold on to. Our role is to be faithful in sharing, but God's role is to actually accomplish something. See, Harvest Bible Chapel is called to spread the seed. We don't have the power to grow it. We don't. But God does. And he promises with every seed that our church plants this year and in the future, every single one of them, they're not just going to sit in the dirt and do nothing. God's going to do exactly what he wants to do with it. Then, of course, there's the final phrase. Hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promises is faithful. We can hold fast to the promises of God because he has been and always will be faithful. So when the sea gets rough, when we don't know what we're headed into, we can hold fast to God's promises. We can lean in harder. We can hang on harder and tighter because we know that God is faithful.
Well, since I've known my wife, she's always wanted a Vitamix blender. And for those of you who don't know what that is, this is the cream of the crop of blenders. This is like the Mercedes of blenders. And this thing could do anything. All it does is just stir things up. And so I'm thinking, like, should I get one for my wife? But it costs like nearly $1,000. So I asked 50 people to pitch in with me to get one for Christmas last year. So I wanted to see what the hype was all about, though, before I made that purchase. So I go to the store, and I go to the salesman, like, hey, what's up with this Vitamix? What is this thing? He's like, oh, bro, listen, this is the best thing money can buy. You could throw anything in here, and it'll just stir things up. You can even throw a brick in there, and it'll turn it to powder. I'm like, why would I want to do that? He's like, that's not the point. It's the technology of the blade. It's all about the blade. It stirs things up. So as Christians, we are called to be the blade that stirs things up for the Lord. Which brings me to the third point. We stir up. Verse 24, Follow along with me, if you will. It says this: let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. Now, to consider one another in the Greek, it means to observe carefully, with diligence, and to look intently. The other word that's used in the Greek, consider, used one other time in Hebrews 3:1. It's calling upon the apostles to consider Jesus Christ. Now, it's not so much to think about, but actually to hone into, to focus on him, to study. And there's an intimacy to be intentional with Jesus. Again, not just to think briefly over. I want you to take a look around the people who are sitting next to you. Do you know them? Have you considered them? Are you being intentional to know who they are, to befriend them? We're all on the same team. So when you truly consider one another, we learn to stir up love and good works in each other. So this verse is just not teaching how to love one another. If we read it too fast, we can misunderstand that and say, like, well, it's just to love one another, right? No, but the verse is actually teaching us, although that is biblical, it's teaching us to stir up one another to love and good works. We're teaching each other to do that with other people, especially those around us. The word here, the stir, this is the verb in the verse. It's to take action. The word here can have a positive or a negative meaning depending on the context. So here's an example of a negative word here that we're going to use. Johnny, here he goes again. He's stirring up trouble at school again. So that is the negative term there. But in verse 24, they're using it in the positive. The positive meaning of stir is to say it's to stimulate or to excite or to encourage one another. So if we read that verse in replacing stir up, let's read it in this way. Let us consider how to encourage one another to love good works, to love and to have good works. So here's what I want to encourage you to do. This is my way of loving you and loving our community. There's opportunities for us to build one another up, to go out into our community and to love others and to have good works. So the good works is proof of our love for God. So we're going to have ample opportunities for outreach starting in the fall. We're going to get like, what, $33,000, Pastor Greg, to use in our community. Because I want to stir up in you how to love our community. And likewise, I want you to do the same with your small group, a family member, your friends, whoever, because McHenry County is ripe for the gospel. We want to go out and share the good news of Jesus Christ with boldness. And we want to present love to people. And we want them to know that this is where Harvest Bible Chapel is at, a place where they can find refuge. And as we go out into the fall, we are going to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen, church? There's going to be great opportunities for us to hold one another up and to help one another to love in our community with a lot of resources and to share the good news of Jesus with boldness.
So we're on commitment number four. Commitment number four, we gather. Turn down, look at your Bible, starting in verse 25. Not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some. So we've heard three commitments so far: draw near, second one, hold fast, third one, to stir up. Now, to hold fast and to stir up, we will never be able to accomplish these things apart from being with one another. If we isolate ourselves or we are not gathered together, we're never going to be able to do these things. And so here in this verse, we see not neglecting to meet together. So these Christians have been facing extreme persecution. Extreme. I mean, people are dying, being thrown in jail all the time, and it's getting hard. They're tired. They've been meeting together in homes and in the synagogue, church. And they're wondering at this point, is it still worth it? And some people were leaving and withdrawing themselves from the church because it was hard. And I think about us, I don't think many of us are facing the same extreme persecution that these believers were, but there are barriers that we face that get in the way of us gathering together. Here are a couple that I thought about. Busyness. We're busy. We have a soccer game on Sunday morning. Or the NFL season starting, so I got to make sure that I'm at the store in the morning, I'm ready to go. My schedule is just filled, and this is small group is a chance for me to have some time to myself, the busyness of life. Sometimes we're tired, we're just worn out, we worked all week. Then on Saturday, we work around the house, we're running around with our kids, and we're tired, and we just want to stay home. And so it prevents us from gathering. Another barrier could be discouragement. We're discouraged. So I was thinking about a few years ago when the Chicago Cubs were in Game 7 of the World Series. Who remembers that game? 108 years away, or since the last World Series, and the Cubs are looking like they're going to do it. They get to the ninth inning, and it just starts to go downhill. And you're thinking, no way is this happening again. And then the rain starts, and they delay the game. And all the Cubs players go into the clubhouse. And I guarantee you some of them were discouraged and thinking to themselves, this can't be happening again. And it could have been real easy for them to go to their locker and just sulk around. But what did they do? Jason Hayward gathered everyone together. Everyone in the team. And said, we're not letting this slip away. They gathered themselves together when they were discouraged. Fourth barrier that we may use to not gather is I don't need it. I have a thing going with Jesus. I know who he is. I got my walk going. I don't need to be with other people. Because here's why, Pastor Brian, it's hard. Church is hard. Relationships are messy. And that's true. That is true sometimes. But God knows that we need one another. He tells us in his word that we need one another. And he's reminding us here not to neglect to meet together. And so he wants us to gather. And here's why. Here's why he wants us to gather. Because we receive from God when we gather. We receive from his word and we receive from his people. We receive two of the commitments we talked about. We hold fast. We stir up one another. When we gather, we get to give to God. We get to bless one another when we gather. And we get to work together, as Pastor Mike was talking about, stirring up one another. Because the truth is that Jesus Christ is the head of the church. He is the head. And one day he's going to gather the church to himself. All believers who put their trust and faith in Jesus Christ, he's going to gather to himself. And so what we're doing when we come together is just a rehearsal for the main event of what we're going to be doing in heaven. And so in 1 Corinthians 12, it talks about this. It talks about the church as a body and how we're all a part of it. And each one of us has a different part and a different role. One might be an ear. One might be a hand, but every part is important. And if it's not there, it's missed. You're missed. You're missed at small group. You're missed at church. And so we commit as God's people to gather together when it's easy and when it's hard. And so we commit to gathering united under the name of Jesus Christ, our fourth commitment.
We draw near, we hold fast, we stir up, we gather, and then finally this, we encourage. We encourage one another. Look at that text right there. Last part of verse 25 says, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. So let me just break that down for you, but encouraging one another. Let's start with the first word right there, which is but. Why is it but and why isn't it and? It could have just as easily been and encouraging one another. And yet here what God is telling us is encouraging one another is standing in contrast to what we just said. So what we learn from the fact that he used the word but, it's saying not neglecting to gather, but encouraging one another. Do you understand that it all starts with the truth that when we gather, we get to encourage one another? This is when we get to encourage one another. We have to show up. We have to be here, and that shows up on our weekend services. This is why we want to gather every single weekend to lift high the name of Jesus Christ. This is why we gather in small group, because we want to encourage one another. Isolation is what's going to lead you down that path of discouragement. If maybe you today feel like your heart is discouraged, one of the things in God's word that is a provision for you is that you would gather so that you could receive encouragement from God's people. And you have to show up, you have to value that and not neglect it. Some of the most encouraging people I know in this church, you need to know that I see this in common with all the people I consider encouraging people. They love gathering with God's people. They come to church so faithfully. They come to small groups so faithfully. They invite people out to lunch. They invite people out to dinner. They spend time with God's people. Why? Because they're encouraging people, and they're not neglecting meeting with one another. So it says, but, and then it gives us the word encouraging. That word in Greek is the word parakaleo. That is a combination of four words, and when you add them all up together, that's how we get to the word encourage, and it's so informative to see how God reveals this to us, encouraging. This is what he wants us to be to one another. So it means these four things: to strengthen, to admonish, to instruct, and to comfort. Let me just walk through those real quick. And just a word of caution, when you're talking about encouraging someone, one of the things that I fear has happened is sometimes people use that term when they really shouldn't be, and they say, hey, I just want to encourage you with this. And what they're saying is, can I just tell you what I think? Can I just give you my personal agenda for you? And that's not what God's word says. It should do these four things. And so one way to know if you're actually encouraging someone is asking yourself, did they actually receive the things that encouragement does? And so here are the things that encouragement is. And these are the questions I ask myself if I'm trying to encourage someone. It means to strengthen. So I ask myself, did they walk away feeling like they have increased capacity after our interaction? Do they walk away feeling like they can keep going? And I know I've been blessed so much by people in this church that when I've had, you know, if we're meeting up for dinner and I have a super long day at work and I'm just tired, I'm physically tired, and I'm like, yeah, but we committed to this dinner and we're going to go. So we drive up to someone's house and we have dinner together with our brothers and sisters. And I leave that dinner, even though I'm just as physically tired, you wouldn't even know it because my soul has been strengthened. And no matter what's going on that day, I'm receiving strength. I'm being encouraged because I'm spending time with my brothers and sisters. Do they leave feeling a way that they have increased capacity? Then it means to admonish. That, I ask myself, do they know what to do? To exhort someone means you're giving them something to do. You're not just want to call them out. I know some of us are more excited about that piece than others, to call someone out and say, hey, don't do this. This isn't what honors God. But it's not just that. It's you call them out, but then you point them towards someone. You admonish them towards something. And so they need to leave this moment of encouragement knowing what they're supposed to do. And then this, to instruct. Did they gain an understanding of God's word? As you were seeking to encourage them, did you actually bring God's word to them? Every time we're trying to encourage one another, we should be quoting scripture as much as possible, because as we're quoting God's word, then we know God is speaking. And that is how God speaks to us. And so we want to be people that encourage one another by instructing each other in God's word. And then finally this, and this really blew me away when I studied this word, that comfort is inside of the word encouragement. Because so many of us think of encouragement a lot more on the admonish and exhort, and that is a part of it. I want to give you the courage to keep doing the right thing. But then inside of this word, we find the reality that it's comfort. Because people need to know that we care. People need to know that you actually care about their soul and about their well-being. And then when they know that, they receive comfort. And then the admonishment can just go that much further. The instruction can go that much further if we know that we are also comforting one another. So, but encouraging, and then it says this, one another. And this is so important for everyone to hear. One another. You need to know that this applies to you. You have to know that this applies to you. God wants every single one of you to be encouraging your brothers and sisters, because the ministry of encouragement is not entrusted to the pastors of a church. It's not our job. The only reason we get to encourage you today with this microphone sitting on this stage, You need to know it's because primarily we're your brothers. And as being your brothers, we get to encourage you. But the ministry of encouragement isn't given to just the pastors or to the staff of a church or even to a select few who would have the gift of encouragement, right? It's for everyone. Think of the gift of evangelism. Just because you don't have the gift of evangelism doesn't mean you just like get a free pass and you don't ever have to witness. Even if it's not your gift, you're still called to it because Jesus said we are to all make disciples. And in the same way, even if you don't have the gift of encouragement, you are to be an encourager. This is the call for every brother and sister in Christ to encourage one another. And you need to know that God gave each one of you a voice to encourage someone. He's given each one of you a voice, and he's given each one of you a platform. And it might not look like the platform of the person sitting next to you, but you still have a platform. And instead of spending your time thinking, man, God, if you open this door, this opportunity, give me this voice, then I'll encourage. No, you're thinking about it wrong. God already has given you a voice. God already has given you a platform. People you know, people you love, and you have an opportunity to encourage them. And don't miss the fact right here that he says encouraging one another. It happens face to face. It happens in person. That's why it stands in contrast to not neglecting gathering, because we have to do this together. And then the passage closes with this sentence, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. And this, here's how we come to a close, and this is how this passage, this thought comes to a close. All the more as you see the day drawing near. Now, right there, it says the day with a capital letter in your Bible. There's a reason for that. It's because it's not just like any day. We're actually speaking about the day when Jesus Christ will come back for us, his church. And that day is drawing nearer and nearer every single day. You know, you could study the end times and you could say, oh, there's these signs and we know that this has to happen first before Jesus comes back. And there's nothing wrong with studying that. I think it's super informative. But don't get tricked into thinking that you can actually figure out the day, because no one knows the day except for God. But here's what I do know is that today we are nearer to that day than we were yesterday. We are near every single day. We're drawing near. And what God's word tells us to do is that we should all the more do the things that we've talked about as the day is drawing near. And you need to know that as time continues, these five commitments that we've shared with you today should be increasing. And that's the application point for today. Think about, as time continues, all five of these things need to be increasing in your life. And as you think over the past year, do you see yourself increasing in your nearness to Christ? Do you see yourself increasing as you hold fast to the promises of God's word? Do you see yourself increasing in stirring up your brothers and sisters to love and good works? Do you see yourself increasing in your commitment to gather God's people and increasing in how you encourage your brothers and sisters? And that's the opportunity we have today as a church. This is us. These are the things that we do, these five commitments. And here's what I want you to do as we close. I just want you to pick the one that God put on your heart that you just know, hey, time's been passing, the day is drawing nearer, but I'm not increasing in that one. I just haven't in this past year. And I just want you to know that's okay. Praise God, you see that now. That's God's grace to you this morning, that you would see that you need to be increasing in one of these commitments. And I just want you to, if you have your notes, like just circle the one if you already know right away. This is what I want to focus on. This has kind of been on the back burner. I need to bring it into the forefront of my sight. I want to focus on this, God, that I would be able to increase as the day is drawing near, all the more that we would be doing these things. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather as your people. For we have seen you to be great. You are the one who changed our lives. You're the one who spoke everything into existence. And yet you know us, and you have called us to be saved, to be yours, to be your people. So, Father, we thank you that today we have the opportunity to really lean into these commitments that we've talked about today. May it be that as we leave, Holy Spirit, would you just bring these things to mind into the week? What are the things you want us to all the more keep doing? Keep increasing in as the day is drawing near. And how we long for that day, Lord. We long for the day when your Son, Jesus Christ, will come back and he will establish his kingdom visibly for all to see. And there will be no elections. There will be no re-elections, for the government shall be upon his shoulders and he shall be king. And we will see him and how we long for that day, God. Come quickly, Lord Jesus, but until that day comes, may it be that we hold fast to the truth of your word, that we commit to these things, for we know that we're yours. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. All God's people said, amen.